Hey guys, we are back in the garage and we are starting a new project and we're going to start everything right now. Yes, I know, I have too many projects on the go that I haven't finished, but today we are going to introduce Nisha's new daily driver. It is a 2005 Honda Civic SI. Now, if you are in the States, you're going to tell me that's not an SI. Well, it's different in Canada. So let's just take a look right now. In Canada, we have the SI, which I believe is the EX in the United States. So there is a coupe and a sedan version of this. This has a 1.7 liter single overhead cam, factory header, makes around 127 horsepower. Not a lot, but it's a great economy car. Now, the SI version that we have, the hatchback for this generation, is the SIR. I just want to make that clear because I know there's going to be a lot of people that are going to comment in the video and not wait for me to finish this part of the explanation saying I'm wrong and that's not an SI. This is an SI Canadian car. Nisha needed a new daily driver. We found this one for a really good price. It only has 155,000 kilometers on it, and it's a 5-speed manual. This video series is going to be unique because we're going to talk about whys. We do a lot of videos of how-tos or what things are or how they work, but we don't talk about why we're changing them as much, or I might talk a little bit snippet. So I am dedicating, whenever you see this car, we're going to talk about why we're changing the part, and we are going to change quite a few parts on this. We're not going to go for power, obviously, because this is an economy car, and it'd be a waste of time to try to make this fast because that's not what this vehicle's purpose is. The vehicle's purpose is to drive to and from work reliably and safely. So we're going to change maintenance items, try to get a little bit better throttle response out of it. We're going to focus on driver feel as well and passive safety. Whenever we get a new car, or a new old car I should say, we always do basic maintenance first, and there's going to be one thing I'm going to show in the video that just makes me feel good. So the first thing we do is we change out the air filter. Now, when I prefer to use the K&N air filters, we're just doing a drop-in style. You don't have to use this. The only thing you have to do is, if you're going to use a disposable filter, is to change it on a regular basis. Now, with the K&Ns, don't throw out the old filter. The reason why I keep the old filter is clean, so when I recharge it, I can let it sit for overnight, let the new one dry, and then when I re-oil it, I can let it sit for a day or two and then put it into the vehicle. But I don't have to worry about that for a few thousand kilometers. So the first thing we do is that, make sure the air cleaner is clean. I will use some sort of fuel injection cleaner. So I like to use Lucas's injection cleaner, the heavy duty one. When we first get the car, run a tank or two using top tier gasoline. I use Shell. You don't have to use Shell. There's lots of other good brands out there like Chevron. I think in the States there's 76. You guys can comment below. Let me know what other brands you guys like. And then for regular maintenance, I like to use their upper cylinder lubricant. I mainly do this because I like to make sure that the fuel pump and the injectors are happy, because I never want to service those, and we never have. We have a Toyota Camry with 240,000 kilometers on it. My daily driven truck has just passed 200,000 kilometers. We've owned each vehicle over 10 years. So this is the regimen that we do. It works for us, and we're going to stick with it. The reason why I use reusable air filters are, for me, they're proven to me. I've been using them for 16 years. I never had an issue. I have changed up my setups. Like on my truck, I had, for roughly, was it 100,000? No. It's close to 100,000. I had that cone filter set up, and I just didn't like servicing it, so I switched over to a panel setup, a drop-in style. And the reason why I like these is, yes, this probably flows very close to a brand new paper style disposable one. The difference though is this one will maintain flow for a much longer period of time, even as it gets dirty, which means I'm going to basically maintain my performance and maintain my fuel economy. While a disposable air filter, as it gets dirty, you lose efficiency of the motor, so your gas mileage will go down. That's the main reason why I like this. A lot of people complain saying, oh, well, those things, you know, they get clogged up with dirt if you're driving gravel roads, blah, 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 blah. The funny thing is, K&N air filters were actually designed for desert racing, because standard filters had the issue they would just get too clogged up and then they would not flow enough air. These things were actually designed for off-road racing in extremely dusty environments. And then other people say, well, they mess up mass airflow sensors, yada, yada, yada. Well, I'm going to say that they're over-oiling their air filters, and that's what's causing it. Because if you do it properly, I haven't had any issues, and there are thousands of people that haven't either. When we purchased this vehicle, I knew it was a diamond in the rough because I was looking at it and I noticed that the fittings here and all the bracketry had rust on it, but the rest of the car was clean. So I asked some questions, and the car did spend some part of its life in Ontario, but that's okay. She did her work, and the previous owner had this thing really rust proof. So looking at the strut tower mounts underneath the vehicle, all the structural stuff, it's rust free. These components aren't really treated from the factory, so they have corrosion on them. So what we did was we just sprayed bits and parts with fluid film or rust converting paint. You know, we look it over. The car seemed pretty solid for the most part, and the price was right. So things like that I don't mind dealing with. But if we have lots of rust on structural components like this or on brake lines, if we look over here, that's going to make me walk away from the vehicle. But it's been an oiled car underneath. Everything looks mint. So that's what we're going to do. So to supplement that, I like to use fluid film, and I will hit key areas inside the fenders, back portions on the firewall, little components. I have a whole video on how to help prevent rust on your vehicle, because when you're buying an older vehicle like this, if you do not do proper maintenance, you can't get that extra 100,000, 200,000 kilometers out of it easily. You might only get 50,000 and start having issues where the repair bills cost more than payments on a new car. So we have to hit that balance, and taking care of the car initially will make sure that we have good life out of it. Now, here's something I notice a lot of people don't think about, but these connections are very important, and they are pretty weather tight for the most part, but we can take it one step further. So what I like to do is I like to take every connector out that I can see on the engine, and if it needs to be cleaned, we'll take electrical contact cleaner, and then we'll put a thin film of dielectric grease in each connector and then put it all back together. Even if you were to unplug it and plug it back in a few times, that will help clean it up if there's any kind of corrosion. But when a car's in good condition like this, I like to make sure that there's never going to be corrosion. So putting that dielectric grease in is really going to help out. And let the rust control begin. It's okay, you're in BC now. You're not going to rust anymore. You see, we've taken off the air box, so I wanted to inspect it. So again, all the plugs over here, taken apart, dielectric grease, fluid filming all the rusted parts, cleaning out. The throttle body was actually pretty clean, but we sprayed some throttle clean in there as well, just to make sure that there's no oil buildup. But like, it was really clean when we took it apart, so I'm really happy about that. You see the throttle linkage has some rust on it, so I sprayed some fluid film in there to help keep it under control. Alright, our new air filter's in. We're ready to bun this part up and move on with our maintenance. I also want to mention that on the grounds, I have upgraded them. So you can see here, I replaced that factory ground. They get corroded quite a bit over time. I added one over here, onto the strut mount, back to chassis. And again, I added one from battery to chassis as well. The reason why I upgrade all the grounds is because your starter motor, your spark plugs, all the electronics rely on electricity to run. So having good grounds makes sure that we have good voltage going to everything, ensuring that all the electronics work properly. I'm also spraying in the window tracks here with silicone lube. What this is going to help do is going to reduce friction on those window motors. That way we get more life out of them. You'll also want to put a little bit of silicone lube on the weather stripping on the inside and wipe it on. This will help the doors from freezing in the wintertime to the vehicle. Now we're letting the oil drain out. It's pretty black. In the service sticker on the windshield, it was due at 157. The car is at 158. Makes sense. You have to keep in mind, when someone's selling a car used, they're probably not going to dump any money into it as far as maintenance. They're just going to ride it out as long as they can. I also want to mention that we thought, like, oh, it's got snow tires, pretty good. These snow tires are so hardened up right now. This car is not that effective in the snow. So we're going to have to change the tires as well. These are the little things you're going to come across on a used car that you have to be prepared for. And while we are down here, we might as well spray some crown and some fluid film on these parts. As you can see, the car looks decent underneath. But we might as well do an inspection right now, see what else we gotta do. We'll probably have to change out those sway bar bushings later down the road as well.
Here's one of the tricks I like to do to make the vehicle last longer. So if you're gonna do an oil change, before you do the oil change, buy a drain plug that has a magnet attached to it. You see, the factory one doesn't. So with a magnet attached to it, when the vehicle settles down, it'll pull all the filings out. We also run a magnet on the filter as well.
One other little trick that I do is, with the drain plug still out, I pour a little bit of fresh oil in. So any sediment that gets stuck at the bottom of the oil pan helps get pushed out. While we're waiting the oil to drain, now's a good time to consult the owner's manual, and we are going to see what our capacity is. So we can see that for the Canadian SI model, it's going to use 3.5 liters. Make sure you know your interval changes, because this is what the manufacturer recommends on how often and the capacities that your vehicle is going to need. That way you can put the appropriate levels in and the appropriate type in as well. Here's our old oil filter, here's our new one. I'm using K&N. So what I do, the reason I use K&N, the biggest reason is I actually like the 1-inch nut fitting on it. Just makes life a lot easier when you have to remove it at the end of the oil cycle and you have to change out the oil again. The other thing I do is obviously we're going to oil the gasket portion to make sure that we get a better seal onto there. It's easier to turn onto it. The other thing you want to make sure is when you take off your old oil filter, make sure that gasket comes off. Make sure it's there and do a visual inspection where this oil filter mates up to the motor, because if you double gasket it and you turn on the motor, you get oil everywhere. And the other thing I do is I will prime the oil filter with oil. This will help prevent a dry start. We want to make sure that we have oil circulating as soon as we fire it up, because on first crank, when the motor's been sitting for a while, new motor, oil change, that's where a lot of wear happens. So we want to make sure we circulate oil as fast as we can throughout that motor. Or engine. A lot of people complain that I say motor and motors for electrical motors and it's not for engines. Well, if you look up the definition, motors for internal combustion and electric. Just to clarify for you guys.
So hopefully you guys can see. Let's see if we got the camera up there. So we have taken the time to clean the mating surface where the gasket meets. We're doing a visual inspection. That gasket is no longer there, and we're also taking the time to clean the threads off just to make sure. And looking here, we're definitely going to have to hit this with some fluid film and some crown to keep that rust under control.
Vehicle on level ground. Let's see what our oil looks like. It's obviously going to be this nice clean golden honey color. We're going to double check, triple check. Wiping off the dipstick, obviously. But I can't do it here because I'm holding the camera. And we're going to double check, make sure everything is plugged in. All our fluids are topped off on top of doing the oil. Then we go ahead and fire up the motor. This is the oil we're using. We're using the manufacturer's recommended viscosity. You don't have to use synthetic and you don't have to use oil supplement. That's up to you. I choose to. The main thing is that you change the oil on a very regular basis. Don't do that once a year oil change stuff. Change it at the manufacturer's recommended intervals, or change it every season if you don't put that many kilometers on your vehicle. All right, so we got the motor running, and sorry, engine, and I'm going to go outside and let you guys listen to it. But I want to mention here, I like it when cars have trip A and B. The reason why I like trip A and B is, one, I don't have to watch the miles rack up and be like, oh man, this thing's high mileage. But I use trip A to monitor fuel economy. Trip B I use so I know my intervals for the oil, so I never touch trip B. And I wait, okay, it's like 5,000, 6,000 kilometers or 8,000, whatever your intervals are, it's time to change the oil. I also want to mention another big maintenance item we did on the car, I had a shop do because I've never done it, I won't say that I can, is changing out the water pump and timing belt. On these Hondas or any kind of interference motor that runs a timing belt, if you're buying it used, even if they have records, if you have the cash, just change it. Unless you know for sure it's actually been changed, you don't want to have that belt snap and then you basically have a giant paperweight of a motor. So the first thing we had done was the water pump timing belt, had new radiator, had new coolant put in the vehicle. That way we're good for another 100,000K. There she is running, very smooth. Before we had a weird ticking noise, I couldn't make out what it was. When we had the water pump and timing belt done, the vehicle stayed overnight at the shop to let it cool down completely. And we had the valves relashed, and that made the motor run a lot smoother afterwards. So these are things that you have to take into account when you're buying a used car. What do you guys think? This is kind of like my starter pack when it comes to any used car or even a new car that we just recently acquired. I like to use these products and I use these products with every service interval. Would you guys use something similar? Would you do similar things? Would you use other kinds of products, maybe change up the frequency, or do you just let the dealership take care of everything? Let me know and comment below. If you like today's content, make sure to check out my channel and hit the subscribe button and make sure to hit that bell notification. What that does is it makes sure that you're always kept up to date with all the content that we're providing with you guys on YouTube. So the way that we have the channel set up is I have the uploads up top. That way, at all times, you can always see if you just hop by the channel what our latest upload is. Plus, with the bell notification, you're going to get some sort of message from YouTube itself. We also have popular uploads, car videos, how-to videos, demonstration and informational videos, and a lot of cool other specific car videos like our builds playlist. I really like the builds playlist because it takes all the theories from our how-to section and it keeps applying it to different vehicles.